Hello everyone, thanks for joining us today. My name's Charles Rice. I'm the host for today's webinar. And our title is A Tribute to Data Attributes. And your presenter for today is Pete Schildebrand. Pete's an application engineer for the Siemens Sim Center products, if you don't know him already.
All right, well, thanks, Charles. Today I wasn't going to spend much time in PowerPoint. I was gonna try and show things in the software. I have a test lab here, and I'm going to start the test lab desktop with an empty project, and we'll talk about these data attributes. When you think of data attributes, Charles, what kind of things come to mind? Like, what kind of attributes would you want to put on data?
Maybe like things related to sampling rate. What else could I want to put on there? Filters used.
Yeah. Today's attributes, I'm going to talk more about bigger attributes. Like, hey, what are you testing?
Oh, that's even important. That's who did it? Because I might have some questions.
Yeah, exactly. Who did it?
Yeah.
What's the test object? Things like that. So yeah, attributes. I mean, you can go from, I guess, very nitty gritty attributes on the data, like what window was used and everything else, to what's my test object? Is there a test procedure? What's the procedure I'm using? Is there a serial number of the test object? All sorts of things like that. So hopefully these attributes are important. I was going to say anyone who joined the webinar today must be a little bit concerned about data and documenting it properly. I don't know like why anyone would show up, because if you don't document your data, nobody can accuse you of anything. But this is for people who want to document the data. So in a test lab, we try and support that. In this documentation page, there's this upper right area where you can add attributes to the data. And you just right click here, you say add new attributes, and you can say something like, hey, I want to have an attribute like the serial number of my test object. And you can say, for example, I want that to only be a number, and then shoot that over and hit apply, and it appears up here. Okay. Notice I can go to edit, and I can type in letters in my serial number, but I can type in a value. And the idea of these attributes that we add up here is that these are attributes that I can use for plotting the data, for searching for the data later, like, hey, find me all the tests run on this serial number and I should be able to find it, et cetera. So I think, what do you think, Charles? What are the percentage of users that actually stop at this documentation page when they're going to take some data?
Not many, but hopefully after this, they'll see the value.
Yeah, I hope so too. These attributes can be put on the project level and on a section level. So a section, you know, like you could have baseline condition, modification A, modification B, whatever you set for the modification. And then when you take the data, if under tools options, under data attributes, you got, let's see if I can, attributes, you can say when creating a new section or when creating a new run, take the user attributes from the project and section and put it into the run. So a run or a measurement, you can't actually set the attributes individually, but you can have these attributes cascade down and be part of the data run. That kind of makes sense so far?
Yeah, that could be pretty handy, actually.
Yeah. So let's add another attribute just to see how this works. We could say test object, right? Mm-hmm. And I could have some text. I can put the value in advance, so I could say ship one or something like that, and then it shows up here. And when I go to edit, it's freeform text. Well, one of the problems with freeform text is if somebody else came in and they typed in ship one with a space, and I had ship one like this, it might make it so the search later doesn't work, right? Because the people are spelling things a little bit different.
Yep.
So another option that you have is rather than rely on people typing things, if you go to lists here, you can say, I want to create a list. So I could make a list called test object. Oh, looks like I have one already. So I'll pick it here. And it has some attributes. And I can add the attributes that I want to use and spell them exactly the way I want them to be. You see that? Now I've added, made it a list. That was this second tab over here.
A list with the Enterprise. I didn't think you were thinking starships. I was thinking like, you know, seagoing ships.
Constitution and old Ironsides. So I got a list of values. And so here, if I take test object, I instead of just making it preform text, I can say, I want you to make it so that people can only pick from a list. I want you to use the test object list. I happen to name it the same as the attribute. And of course, I could pre-populate it with the attribute. So now if I hit OK, now when you come here, you can only pick from a list. But that would make it very consistent later on if we were going to do searches for the data and things like that. Everything would be spelled exactly the same. You see the benefit of a list there, Charles?
Absolutely.
Nice thing about this, these attributes when you set them up is that, let's just set up one more before I, operator or something like that, objector, I meant to say operator. So I got three attributes. If I save this project as a template, and so this is like my standard test or whatever, and I create shortcut on desktop, the nice thing about that is whenever we open our standard test here, these attributes will be here for the person to fill in. So it makes it easy for them to do that. On the other hand, if you are in a project, and you wanted to grab this attribute list, it's possible to take this attribute list. So for example, I can say save attribute list, and I'll call this like test or something like that. And then if none of these attributes existed, let's say I got rid of them, I can come back here to tools, load attribute list, and I can grab that attribute list and either append or overwrite what was there. So
nice. I didn't know that trick.
Yeah. Attribute lists can be shared, if you will. All right. So we got some attributes in this project. And I just want to show, like, if I go to the navigator, for example, and I, let's say I go here to this select columns, these attributes appear. I can go to, and I have to go to Test Lab because it's a Test Lab thing, Test Lab project. And notice there's a bunch of attributes in here that begin with UA. UA, short for user attributes. And I can pick test object here, for example. And I could also pick out of the list operator. As soon as you create the attribute in documentation, it's available, if you will, in throughout the software. It's also available in a display. So if I go to a legend and the options in the legend, same thing if I pick test lab project here, you know, operator, test object, appear there as well. Does that kind of make sense?
Yeah.
So I can have that appear on the plot automatically, or I can add it as a column here. Making sense so far?
Making sense.
Yeah. So what's the benefit of this? Well, maybe if I go to a directory, let's see if I can find one that contains some projects. I can use those. Actually, the filters are normally off by default, so I'll turn it off initially. Let's see. I have a few directories here, Charles. So I have a directory called Multiple Projects. And notice that when I picked multiple project directory here, there are a bunch of projects in here, but it also shows me those attributes. That's pretty nice, huh?
Yeah. Some interesting projects you've been working on. Abe Lincoln,
yeah.
MacGyver.
and then you can filter. Yeah, I have a few people, you know, that I work with. That
some important customers.
Yeah. So, yeah, if I wanted every project that was done by MacGyver, I can pick MacGyver here, and it shows me that. Or I can pick, you know, based on the test object, right, like attributes. So that's pretty nice, I think, for being able to look at these. You could also, if you're in these projects, and you right-click on it, or you don't even have to be in the project, I can just pick properties here, and there's another tab, attributes, that shows the attributes right there. You can set up columns to look at it, or you can just right-click, pick properties, go to attributes, and do that. Make sense?
Yeah.
In this project, there's some FRS, right?
Mm-hmm.
And notice it's showing Enterprise 2 because we added that to the legend. But it's also possible, like if you're doing printing, to say, hey, I want to make a print format, and I can show attributes on that as well. So when I pick Make Print Format here, under File Printing Options, I have Electronic and PowerPoint as my destination here. So I'm going to say Make Print Format, and it picks, it's going to make a format in PowerPoint. If under Printing Options I had said Word, and then I say Make Print Format, then it says, you know, it's going to make a Word file format. Does that kind of make sense to you, Charles?
Yeah. So we got to make the right choice there depending on what we want. Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm going to say Make Print Format here. This might go to my other screen. I'll overwrite it because we want to do one from scratch. And it did go to my other screen. I'll move it over in a second here. Okay, so here it is. So I got it, dumped this graph into PowerPoint. But because it's Make Print Format, I can create my own format. Under add-ins here, Test Lab will add its own little set of attributes or toolbar to your add-ins in PowerPoint. So here I can say new field,
mm-hmm.
and it's going to pick up based on the graph that I have selected. It comes up with a selector menu of fields that I can add to the plot. And so under Test Lab, there is a project. And under project here, I can say simple things like I want to show the project name, for example, so that would add the project name. But I can also pick these user attributes, like the operator, yeah. which I didn't have on there.
Yeah, and he's not who to blame for this data, so that's a good one.
Yeah, so I got that there. I guess I missed the project name. Maybe I'll go back and go get it. So it, you mentioned a lot of the other attributes, you know, like sampling rate and stuff like that earlier, Charles. This mm-hmm. this is how you would get those. I mean, these like project name, that is a standard attribute that's available because we're using a project file, right?
Right.
Sampling rate on a block is also available. So go back in again and just show you where that is to give you an idea. So because that's not an attribute of the project, sampling rate, it's actually still a Test Lab file, but it might be on the data block, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this
yeah.
is considered a block, the FRF function. And then I can pick something like frequency resolution, for example, and add
yeah,
that.
That's a good one. Yeah.
So you just go down and pick that. So I added three attributes here. And of course you could have a logo or whatever, you know, and you could read into PowerPoint, you know, your company.
Branding is very important.
So there's our fancy logo. I'll hit save.
Famous high company. Yes.
And now what I should be able to do is not make print format, but print. And because I use the default name, front back, same name as this, I can just pick print and it picks it up. But if I called my format something weird like Fred or Tom, I could pick print with and select Fred and Tom to print this. So I'm picking print, and it says it wants to make an electronic copy. So let's say test here, I'll hit save on the desktop, and it should create a PowerPoint file on my desktop. So PowerPoint will run in the background. Looks like it's opening the front back. Let's see, yep. Temporarily doing a test. Now it popped in. And hopefully it should close it soon. I think yep. Normally at least it's open. Then that temporary file went away. Now I can double click on test here.
Nice.
There it is.
All frequency my resolution, project name.
So that's the general idea. You can grab these test objects, operator, all these attributes. You can use them for searching for the data. You can use it for plotting the data. And there's even, you know, if I had something like this and I go to search here, you can, there is a search functionality because everything might not be in one directory. But when you pick this search, you can choose to search subfolders. And so mm-hmm. I can pick properties to search by, like the test object, for example, and hit search now, and it goes out and it'll find all the test objects that match that criteria. So including in subdirectories.
Yeah. That's pretty powerful, actually.
Yeah, and pretty simple.
Yeah, it's probably not even used very often, but hopefully now people can not be clicking through endless folders trying to find their projects, can quickly search, especially if they got some good attributes.
Yeah, and I was going to say, I don't think it's overly burdensome. Would you agree with that?
No, no. Easy peasy.